speaker. Our next speaker is John Hart, who is professor and department head of MIT's Mechanical Engineering Department, and he'll talk about manufacturing and design.
Thank you all for being here. I'll give you a short perspective on how AI and perhaps computing in general can help connect design to future production infrastructure. And let's start with a simple manufactured object, a Lego brick. And I'd like you to think about how you would encode the instructions to manufacture just one Lego. Not just the geometry, but the tooling and the information required to achieve the precision, the tolerances that allow something as simple as a Lego to fit together so precisely. And then the creativity and breadth of components required to, you know, put together models of the city of Boston, for instance. So about 100 years ago in manufacturing, Ford Motor Company brought the moving assembly line to life. And perhaps like Legos, the ability to deploy interchangeable parts, standard components on a moving assembly line, let humans make a very complex product at a scale never before achieved, here the Model T. And there have been many changes in manufacturing over the past 100 years, and I think one of the most important changes is this constant push and pull between humans and automation. We see more automation in any manufacturing facility from small to large, and we know that, for instance, the front end of most automobile plants are largely roboticized, largely automated. And along the way, through the latter part of this 100 years, of course, we've also built the semiconductor industry and consumer electronics. And you know, compare putting together a Lego model of the basketball arena in Boston to the information and knowledge required to manufacture something such as a smartphone. And looking back at this 100 years of transformation in manufacturing, I thought that an important change has been actually the disaggregation of knowledge from single organizations, you know, organizations such as Ford in the 1920s and the craft production houses of the Industrial Revolution, into far, far distributed supply chains. So there was a time when most organizations had design and manufacturing process development and production in one location or one company. And over time, I believe it has spread out. And of course, what makes such sophisticated products possible today is the fact that we rely on increasingly intricate and complicated relationships between the products we design and where the material comes from and every little small component that is necessary to make the product achieve its function. And if you disaggregate something like an iPhone, you realize how intricate the orchestration of all those activities is. So my main point, which I'll try to articulate with a few examples, is how can we think about beginning to collapse this complexity? How can we continue to advance manufacturing forward and therefore enable the designs of the products of the future, but do it in a way that allows us to deal with this complexity challenge? And we see many emerging tools, first tools for the front end for design. For instance, what some folks call generative design, not really a generative AI, but the process of, instead of creating a 3D CAD model, defining the constraints, the loads, and so on, and generating a complex geometry, as you see at the top left, and emerging research, such as from the Decode Lab at MIT, using generative approaches to generate products with many, many components, and even think about specifying the function and appearance of something like a bicycle using natural language. And our colleagues in CSAIL, Professor Wojciech Matusik, published a really fascinating paper over the summer that said, what are all the things we can do with current generation LLMs, here GPT-4, across the design to manufacturing workflow? And with, I think, a bit of hand-holding, they showed that it's possible to give an initial design specification, use existing tools that convert code into 3D CAD models, and then even reach into online catalogs, select components, generate machine code, and produce something like a simple bookcase using a laser cutter, using well-established digital prototyping tools. So here's a simple way of thinking of it. we have three layers, and we need to think about how to connect the product and process design in an integrated fashion to an emerging production infrastructure that will be and must be more digital through the use of multimodal AI tools. So I'm not really going to talk about the middle. I don't know much about it. But I'll talk more about the top and the bottom. And so for the bottom, we can think of the production infrastructure as a series of processes. You know, Lego brick has just one process, injection molding, but more or less everything is made using multiple processes. So we can think of this as kind of a grid of different capabilities, machining, injection molding, surface finishing, painting, polishing, you name it, and how those processes stitch together within organizations and across supply chains that achieve finished products. And in my opinion, in my own research here, one of the most exciting technologies, not an all-encompassing technology, is 3D printing, additive manufacturing, which now, after 30-plus years of being on the scene, is only starting to shape certain production-scale manufacturing systems. So this is a picture of a company that spun from MIT called Vulcan Forms, about an hour west of here in Devens. There is a large factory built around a next generation additive manufacturing technology. Each of these boxes is a machine that uses about 100 kilowatts of laser power to print metal parts from powder. It can print large components of jet engines, which would traditionally be made by forging or casting, and can also print components of medical implants. Such as here you see about 144 cups used in orthopedic implants. And what makes this possible is not just the hardware, but of course the software that drives the machines and the ability to start with a CAD model of the design with a sophisticated geometry, could be generatively produced or traditionally produced, simulate the process ahead of time, send the instructions to the machine, and then print the part layer by layer and collect information as the process goes on and perform inspection digitally. And also, in a way, it redefines the role of the worker, the relationship between the human and the machine, because instead of having operators at each machine, the operators are centralized and are working with image processing tools and trained AI models for detecting and correcting defects on the fly. And considering other elements on this bottom floor, there's a lot of exciting emerging technologies, Lego bricks, if you will, that we're seeing emerge. You can roboticize sheet metal forming. So for a certain collection of parts, you can use models of the solid mechanics and deformation of a sheet metal, so sheet metal forming can be performed without a fixed piece of tooling. And there's many other exciting 3D printing companies, such as Inkbit, another MIT spinout, that have extraordinary capability to print multiple materials and objects that have not been possible before. You could say only the things that something like an AI model could dream up. And there's other technology that interfaces with the human workers who are not going away, such as Tulip, which creates heads-up instructions and allows workers on the factory floor and their supervisors to build apps and work with data. So hopefully you see a bit of the top and a bit of the bottom. And to start to stitch these things together, from my perspective as a mechanical engineer, I think we need truly manufacturing-aware design platforms that consider materials, process capabilities, and performance requirements and goals. We need more digital-first process technologies that allow us to encode the instructions of production, not just the geometry, but the instructions of how to create components and how to fit them together. And the in-between is absolutely fascinating to me, what will emerge and what we'll be able to build from in terms of the multimodal AI models of the future. So I know time is short, so I'll just leave you quickly with three considerations. The first is, I believe the future is more sophisticated designs. So now we can think of how to collapse assemblies, collapse supply chains into fewer components and higher performing objects. This is a jet engine from GE where they've used 3D printing to collapse 300 parts to single components, largely designed by humans. And the right is an algorithm that is used to create a prototype rocket engine that considers the optimization of the combustion process. Second, while manufacturing infrastructure, factories are typically fixed, I think production can and will become much more flexible. And that's a fundamental change to the architecture of how components and products are sourced if we can abstract representations using data and models. And third and finally, I think we have the opportunity and the challenge to look at how value is distributed. Perhaps as manufacturing has become more fragmented, the value add in manufacturing, while still very important, has been pushed down, and we have an opportunity to increase that if we can think about how to redistribute value using these capabilities. Thank you.